Impose not on the mortal's tremulous breast the dire ordeal of foreknowledge. He is warning Narad to hold back his knowledge. Here are not peaks of Kailas and Vaikuntha. But he also says, he has understood the whole thing, Narad. But he also says, all right, you are the singer of ultimate ecstasy. And you also know that the doom is going to be full. Savitri is going to make the danger. But don't give that foreknowledge to us. If at all you want to give the foreknowledge, it is one condition on which you can give the foreknowledge. And that condition is, if thou canst lose her grip, then only speak. If you have that power, that authority to lose the grip of fate, of doom, yes, go ahead and then speak. Otherwise, don't give us that foreknowledge. In other words, he wants that knowledge to be given and that grip to be loosened by him. He must be, because the doom is there. In fact, that is one of the best possibilities the father can work out for his daughter. She is going to meet doom. But if there is somebody who can save it, he will implore his help. If thou canst lose her grip, then only speak. This is important. And he says, yes, you have come with a purpose. It is not a casual visit. You had time very well in a certain context. And there is a meaning, there is significance of your visit here. And therefore, you are here to give us that knowledge and loosen. Means Narada's contribution is a positive contribution in the life of Savitri, in that sense, you see. Perhaps from the iron snare there is escape. Yes, doom is there, but there is an escape also possible. Perhaps the blindness of our will is fit. Okay. He said and answered not. Obviously, what can Narada say? He is asking for foreknowledge, doom. He is also telling him, yes, you can come out and speak if you can loosen the grip. Narada is not only tightening the grip, he is rather making it more and more tight in order to relieve it fully. So the dialogue goes on. And then suddenly, Savitri's mother comes on the scene. In 1925, Savitri's mother was introduced in the epic. And she is here now to play her role, you see. The human aspect of the narrative. And she says, Narad, you have come, Savitri has come, such an auspicious moment for us and all that. Thy bright arrival, you have come at a very auspicious moment, therefore it's a bright arrival of yours. Savitri's mother is seeing very positive sign in the visit of Narad here, you see. Bright arrival. Now, bright, of course, in the context of the story, is something beautiful to happen. Bright also means Narad is a bright person. He is a heavenly being, you see. You are not like human beings who come in this. Then let the speech benign of griefless fear confirm this blithe conjunction of two stars. Now, there are people who say that Savitri has come back after meeting Satyavan. And her parents are there. Narad is there. Ashwati is asking Narad, yes, Savitri has found his youth as a life partner. And he asks Narad, what do you think of this? In the common language, what do you think of this one? And Narad immediately cast the horoscopes of these two persons, of Satyavan and Savitri, and tries to match whether the horoscopes are matching or not. The conjunction of two stars. So this is taken as the astrological matching for the purposes of marriage. Yeah, the stars, the planets, you see. Yeah. Yes. So people interpreted that Narad had cast the horoscopes, and then he's seeing the planetary positions and all that of these two horoscopes, and then says, yes, yes, it's all right. He says, everything is perfectly okay, but there's a little danger, but that also will pass. That is how the general interpretation is given. I will not name the person, but that is how it is given in one place, you see. And sanction joy with a celestial voice. Here, drag not in the peril of our thoughts. Let not our words create the doom, the fear, etc., etc. And then she goes on. She tells him, look, we are living in the mortal world, full of suffering and grief and all that. And too heavy falls on man's heart, the shadow. Let this particular occasion be such that we are not subject to it. That is the natural desire of the mother for a child. And chance entanglement of an alien fate. Then of course she also says, obviously, for perfect reasons, if there is an unseen doom, if the wings of evil brood over this house, then also speak, so that we can prepare ourselves in advance, avoid the danger. If it is good, no problem at all. If there is something bad, let us know that also, and so that we can prepare ourselves. But Narada answers, what help? Yes, I may give you the provision. In what way it is going to help you? Without that foreknowledge, you can pass very safely through the doom and all that. That is the first answer. None can refuse what the star host demands. Her eyes are fixed upon her piety aim. No cry of prayer can turn her from her path. There is no question of my giving knowledge. Nobody is going to turn her face to her. She has leaped an arrow from the bow of God. She has done that thing. The arrow cannot be now taken back at all. It has been shot. And then he says, the poet says, commentary, what Narada told the queen, his words were theirs who live unforced to grieve. Unforced to grieve. They are for celestial beings. We are forced to grieve. They are not for us. These words. And Narada keeps quiet, but Savitri's mother, she is insistent. She is asking him, you are keeping quiet, it means there is something dangerous. And therefore, please let us know what that stealthy doom is. Who is standing in her way? What evil thing stood, smiling by the way, and wove the beauty of the Shalva boy? It is the evil who has taken the form of Satyavan. What is that evil? Let me know. Perhaps he came, an enemy from her past, to take the full revenge in this life. And of course, this is in the context of her daughter. And finally, she says, "Even strangers' anguish rends my heart, my neighbors, my friends, my acquaintance. Even if I walk on the road and see somebody, their anguish rends my heart. And this, O Narad, is my well-loved child." So Savitri, "Hide not from us our doom, if doom is ours." She is pleading, "Let me know." She is insisting. In fact, Narada was waiting for this. He had prepared the occasion for her to say this. "Hide not from us our doom, if doom is ours." He is happy that she has asked this thing. She has made this statement, you see. Of his own accord, he would not like to give. And then, of course, she says, common language, "To know is best, however hard to bear." I don't know whether it's true or not, you see. Even if it is bad thing to happen, it is good to know that bad thing to happen. I don't know if it is good or not, you see. I think it is an act of tremendous grace that the future is kept hidden from us. It is kept hidden from us. It is an act of tremendous grace. Because we have not really prepared ourselves to meet the future. We have not done enough qualifying sadhana, preparation to face fate. Therefore, it is an act of grace. And Narad, as he was waiting all the while, maybe almost for 1 hour, to make this utterance, to deliver what he has to deliver. "Truth thou hast claimed, and I go to thee the truth." Etc. He now describes all the beautiful qualities of Satyavan, etc. as we have seen. His speech carries the light of inner truth, the large-eyed communion with the power and all those things. He speaks very glowingly about Satyavan. "A will to climb lifts a delight to live," etc. "His sweetness and his joy attract all hearts to live with his own in a glad tenancy. His strength is like a tower built to reach heaven." He got it, quarried from the stones of life. Yes, quarried from the stones of life. That is how the evolutionary Satyavan has evolved to this point. Quarried from the stones of life. And then he is coming now to the business. He is such a glowing person, etc. "Oh loss, if death into its elements, of which his gracious envelope was built, shatter this vase." He was quarried from the stones of life, if that vase is shattered. If the earth could not keep too long from heaven a treasure thus unique, loaned by the God, a being so rare of so divine a make. And then he is now making the announcement. "In one brief year, when this bright hour flies back," his bright arrival was there, now this is the bright hour, he is making the announcement, "and purchased careless in a branch of time, this sovereign glory ends, heaven lent to earth." Sovereign glory, that is Satyavan, it ends, lent by heaven. "The splendor vanishes from the mortal's sky. Heaven's greatness came, but was too great to stay. It has to go back." And then he is now very specific. "The year, the month, the day, the moment are fixed in the calendar of destiny. Samvatsaram, Masa, Kala, Muhurta, as the story of Vyasa in Savitri Mahabharata says. Muhurta, time, everything is fixed. And that is important, because on the fated day, Savitri is going to count back now the time, the year, the moment, everything is counted. 12 swift winged months are given to him and her. This day returning, Satyavan must die. This is the important thing, as we have seen. Must die. He says must, and therefore it is the bright hour. It is the bright hour that he must die. Naturally, the human queen, she would not accept such a statement. When then can be heaven's grace? And she tells Savitri, look Savitri, this is what is being told to you. You have chosen somebody, but he will die 1 year after the marriage. Be wise and make another choice. Choose once again and leave this fated hate. Death is the gardener of this wonder tree. Narada described Satyavan as the wonder tree in glowing terms. But who is guarding the tree? Death. Love, sweetness, leaves his pale marble hand. And she says, plead not that choice, for death has made it vain. It's a very powerful argument, you see. You are saying this is done. You said that when you are not aware of death. Now that you are made aware of death, would you still say this is done? Would you still say this is done?